Today we will start by looking at the inverse kinematics of a planar manipulator. So geometry is very simple, and I think if this problem was given to you 2 years ago without doing any robotics, you would have been able to do it. Okay. So the problem is very simple. We are asking that if you are given, so you have a point P, and then at the end of a two-link system. And then we are saying that if you are given values of Px and Py in the coordinate system xy that you have here, what are the values of theta 1 and theta 2? Okay. Now, the only change perhaps from doing the course in robotics so far is that you look at the way I have marked out theta 2. Okay, so I have joined up this axis with this axis, and along this line I have extended it, and I am measuring theta 2 from here. Okay. Now, if you notice carefully, this is exactly what I am supposed to do as per the Dennewitt and Hartenberg formulation. Okay, because I have a z axis which is here, and then I have another z axis which is here, so they are all coming vertically out of the paper. So the common normal has to lie along that. Okay, and yes, there is an infinity of common normals. But obviously, this is a planar manipulator, it would be stupid of me not to put it in the plane. Okay. So essentially then this becomes your direction for x, so you measure theta 2 like this. Okay. So that is the only robotics thing we have done so far. Now once you do that, you get the equations in this form Px and then Py, okay, which is trivial trigonometry. Now we need to solve for theta 1 and theta 2. Okay. So to do that, the obvious thing is to square and add, because you know that you will get a cos square theta 1 term and a cos square theta 2 term and a sin square theta 2 term, which are going to add and remove from the solution. Now in doing that, before I start doing it, the question is there a problem in doing that? Perhaps, because the moment I square, that means that whether I have Px equal to L1 cos theta 1 plus L2 cos theta 1 plus theta 2, or I have minus Px equal to L1, the same thing, if I square and add, I have identical equations. Okay. So if I am squaring and adding it, any solution which I get out of this is going to fit 4 equations. Right? One is Px equal to RHS, and another one is minus Px equal to RHS. Similarly, minus Py equal to RHS and minus Py equal to RHS. So there is a problem in squaring. Okay. So we are solving for many more equations. We do not know which solution we are getting, but we will worry about it later. But let us keep this in mind. So fine, if you square and add, then things simplify, cos square theta plus sin square theta 1 equal to 1, so you, that is where you get these terms like L1 lands up being L1 squared, and the L2 term lands up being L2 squared. So you have to simplify everything, you can write theta 2 as cosine inverse of Px, Py, so on and so forth. So far it is pretty much school kinematics, I mean school trigonometry, with just this word of caution that I am squaring it. And I have used the DH parameter when I am when I am working with that. So the two values of theta 2 that you get, right, they are of the same magnitude, they are opposite in sign when you take a cosine inverse. Now so how do you get theta 1? You do the obvious thing, you substitute, you obtain a value, and you can substitute it, and you can get expression for Px, you get expression for Py. Okay. And so next thing you can do is you can use either of these two equations, either this, no, why does this keep moving forward, or this one to solve for it. This is not a very good idea. Why? So if I substitute for theta 2 in this, so I will get an equation of something a constant times cos theta 1 plus a constant times sin theta 1 is equal to a constant, and that you have known since you crammed for JEE or your entrance exam that how to solve this, right? There is very simple substitutions, you will see that later in the course. But that substitution also involves a another cosine inverse or another sine inverse, right? So, you have again you get two solutions. Can I do better than that? Okay. You can do better than that because you have two equations here. Now, we can take these equations. Now, once I know theta 2, see a term like this is a constant. So, similarly this term is a constant and this term is a constant. So, this is essentially a set of simultaneous equations in cosine of theta 1 and sine of theta 1. So, I can solve these uniquely for cosine of theta 1 and sine of theta 1, okay. And so, I can know theta 1 uniquely, okay. And so, there is this function called a tan 2 which is there in every programming language. Familiar with it? No? Arctan you are familiar with, right? Arctan takes how many arguments?
One
argument. So, there is always a function called a tan 2 which takes two arguments, okay. And it essentially takes the vertical component and the horizontal component and it gives returns a value between 0 and 2 pi or in some cases between minus pi and basically between 0 and 2 pi. Tan, what is the range of tangent values, a tan values? Between 0 and pi, right? Or is it been, no, it has been minus pi and plus pi.
Minus pi by
2, so plus pi by 2, right? And similarly, sine is between 0 and pi and cosine is again between 0 and pi, yeah. So, but this returns over 0 to 2 pi, so that you also locate it in the right quadrant. So, this function is there and you have the rough definition of that, you know. So, a by b if a is greater than or equal to 0 and minus tan inverse a by b otherwise, okay. So, so if you use this then you get a unique value, okay. So, we finally land up with two solutions, okay. And now, these two solutions that we land up with, they are not actually mathematical problems. See, I said I squared and added, okay. So, it is not that I am generating the solution because of that, these two solutions are physically there. So, one of them is elbow up, other one is the elbow down solution, okay. This you should have known from your kinematics course. In the 4-bar solution also, you land up with this. Now, this is there mathematically, so I can find two. Right. But if I did a bad solution in the previous step, used one of the equations to evaluate theta 1, then I would land up with 4 solutions. You would find it very difficult to find 4, you in fact 4 solutions do not exist to this, okay. So, one has to be aware when you are finding inverse solutions as to what is the number of physical solutions which are there and then do the mathematics, eliminate all the spurious solutions. So, that you land up with the correct number of solutions. That is the challenge, okay. Now, obviously, the idea is not to find the solution for a planar tooling manipulator, right? That is ridiculous. You could have done it long ago. Idea is to find it for a 6 degree of freedom manipulator, 5 degree of freedom manipulator, which actually used in the industry. And so, here, there is this proof by Raghavan and Roth, okay. It is a JMD paper roughly around 1990, I am not sure about 1990, okay. So, where they showed that even if you have arbitrary values of d, a and alpha, okay, and you have a 6-link manipulator, serial manipulator, you can have at the most 16 solutions, no more, okay. Now, obviously, if your alpha is 90 degree or 0 degree, in some of them your number of solutions keep on decreasing, okay, because system becomes more constrained. But the maximum number is 16. So, if you follow a procedure and you're exceeding 16, then you know that you can get a better solution. Okay. For most industrial manipulator, you'll end up with 4 solutions, 2 solutions, 4 solutions, 8 solutions, whatever. Well, 4 is about a minimum because there are 2 known singularities. We will discuss that, where we can have at least 2. So, every time you do inverse kinematics, you would inevitably have this non-uniqueness problem. You will have multiple solutions. Okay. And there are physically multiple solutions possible of the elbow up, elbow down kind, right shoulder, left shoulder kind, depending on the class of the manipulator. Now, if you are dealing with a 6-degree of freedom robot, the problem in general becomes 2 involved, to attempt outright trigonometric solution. Now, what Raghavan and Roth did is something little different. We will not get into that. And specifically, there is a problem with representation of orientation. So, if I essentially say, okay, you know, I want the end of the welding rod to point here like this. So, there is a problem with specifying what the orientation is. Okay, it is, you can specify the direction cosine which points in this direction, possibly in a vector form. Right, and then now to deal with that in trigonometry is a little difficult. Now, given this direction cosine, we can say, okay, we want the z coordinate of the end effector axis to point along this direction. So, next question comes is, what about the 2 other axes? Right, you can say, okay, I want the x axis like this. Now, you ask me why, x axis could also go like this. Essentially, that is the issue of being able to rotate the welding rod. Sometime it is not important, sometime it is important. If you are inserting a square rod, then the orientation becomes important, then you can get 2 directions out. usually you tackle this problem, you have a method which utilizes the transformation matrices and that is used. Now, it is also possible that most manipulators, I told you in the first day, that they have a decoupled thing, they have a wrist at which there are 3 coinciding axes. So, you can treat it as a problem of positioning a point in space and then you handle the orientation problem. That is also possible to do so. But it is, you can finally, when you solve for them, see in the end we just land up with couple of sine inverses and cosine inverses. But the question is, when you are dealing with a new robot or you create a new configuration and you want to get it, you want to make sure you have everything right. Now, that is aided by following a systematic method. So, we will look at that next. So, what do we do? So, we had this equation we derived the other day, right. So, I am just moving this matrix over to the other side. So, multiply my inverses on both sides. So, this side keeps on decreasing in size, this size keeps on increasing repeatedly. Okay. And so, other thing is that I have used AI to represent this double index thing just for simplification. Okay. And all these equations that we see, they are essentially mathematically equivalent. There is no difference between them, but they are functionally very different. Now, let us see what happens to them. And then, we are specifying the state of the end effector matrix. Okay, we are saying this is where we want it to be, this is how we want it to be oriented. And the other part is, each of these matrices A1 to A6, they contain only one unknown quantity, which is the joint variable, which is either theta I or di. Okay. So, what we do is, we just start evaluating them from one side, one at a time, moving the matrices over. Okay, so, let me go back to the previous slide. So, this matrix is fully known. Now, when I pre-multiply with this, now this has only one variable. So, now this side has only one unknown, right? And after I have solved for say theta 1, then again this side will have only one unknown. So I'm perennially left with one unknown on the left hand side. Yeah, you have a question.
So you said in the next when we do one more inverse prediction, there will be just one.
Yes, because when I'm doing this, I'm solving for theta 1, say. The variable which is in A1, I'm going to solve for that.
But right side is also unknown.
Which one?
Right side.
Yes, that is the trick. Right side is unknown. But it is possible, but right side is not completely unknown, right? I know everything about the bottom row. 0001. But that does not give me any information actually. It's always 0001. But we will see. If your structure is right, then it works out interestingly that you can always go and solve for them. We'll look at that method. So there are specific reasons why we can solve for them. Because these are industrial manipulators. If you take the general manipulator, then you cannot solve for it using this method. For that, there are other methods which you can look up that paper. There are several other papers. There is another paper by Manocha which came out roughly around about the same time, which has a more compact solution. So that's a different issue. Okay. And so you solve for a variable, move that matrix over to the left. Solve for the next one, repeat, okay? And we look at essentially through the Stanford arm. You can do it for most industrial manipulators. I'm picking the Stanford arm because this one has in particular one sliding member, okay? So most robots will have revolute joints and evolute joints, so I could have solved for that also. But this is interesting, one at least one sliding member. So you get used to it. And then look at the joint at the wrist. There's axis in this direction, there's axis in this direction, and then there's a third axis in that direction. Okay. So you could in principle find out, you know, the first axis goes here, the second axis goes here, the third goes here. So you can find out the DH parameters related to this. You can form the matrices. So we'll look at this. So I'll jump. I'm not forming the matrices, that you can pretty much do. And so the left hand side, so here, this is what I was talking about. There is only cosine of 1, theta 1 is unknown, right? And when you multiply these two together, you get very, very symmetric terms, okay? You get very symmetric terms, and so because of the symmetry of the terms, it is often convenient to define a function like this. So if you take a vector defined by x, y, z, the three components of the vector. So you define a function 1, function 2, function 3 of V. Now function 1 is cosine of theta 1 times the x component, sine of theta 1 times the y component. Now the whole idea is that then you can represent this set by just this vector, a set of function 1, function 2, function 3 operating on the vector n. This is your vector n, okay? It is just compact notation, because if you do not do it, you are going to run out of page size. Now it is not a problem, okay? It is not a problem because you can do it in Mathematica Maxima, and then you can have very large terms which you cannot see on your screen. That does not help you either. You cannot take a printout. So this is just compact notation. There is a lot of compact notations like the tensor notation, you are familiar with that, right? So just making the notation compact so that we can deal with it. And let us look at the right hand side, more complicated, okay? And however, look at this one. Known d2, right? That's a, now the sliding motion which was there was d3. D2 is, which one is d2? This, the, you have this axis and then you have this axis, the gap, so roughly between the center of this to this axis, so this much is d2. That is a constant, which gives me an idea. right? So essentially F3 on P is equal to D2, so sin theta 1 Px plus cosine theta 1 Py is equal to D2, and this is what we are talking about. You have known this for many years now, how to solve this set of equations. You just substitute Px equal to R cos phi, Py equal to R sin phi, proceed and you get a solution. Okay. So you get sin phi minus theta 1 is equal to D2 by R. You just take a spot check. Am I sure that this term is always by definition less than 1? Right? Why? Because when I write the program, I do not want it to crash. Trying to find a sign of a number greater than 1. Okay, so you have got to check physically. Now, what is R? It is square root of Px squared plus Py squared, right? If you think carefully, this is D2, this is the sliding joint, this angle is 90. So, R is always the hypotenuse of a right angle triangle, which has to be always greater than that of the other two sides, right? So, physically, you know that this is good, that this is always possible. Can you say this of any other triangle? In case of obtuse triangle, but if I obtuse and I start extending backward, then this become acute, right? So it's a problem, could be a problem, right? So one has to think. So now if you want to make a robot with a sliding joint, I should make sure that that is reasonably close to 90 degrees, right? And so, and how close depends on the value of D2. If D2 is this much, then you know you can deviate a little, but if D2 is very small and your extension is very large, then your error margin will go down. So these are considerations, okay? And okay, so I am good with this. So you can come out with the solution. So since we know tan inverse uniquely using a tan 2, so this essentially yields two solutions. Okay. And so where are the two solutions? It is pretty much this, that once I know what Px, Py is, this angle is uniquely determined. Okay, so this is my global x0. So this angle is uniquely determined. So now I am asking, okay, I am sitting here and I know that this is D2, so how many, and that this angle is 90 degrees. So how many solutions are possible? So I would take this line, I would draw a semicircle on top of it, and then I would take D2 and I will have two intersections, right? One here and one there. So there are two solutions which are physically possible. And you can very clearly see why these are called the right and the left shoulder solutions, right? So one of them is like this, one of them is like this. Okay. Now, the question here now is, which is angle theta 1? It's not trivial. If I ask this question, your first tendency will be to say, this is theta 1, right? Now, the z0 axis is coming up or going down, whatever. The z1 axis is along this line, either going this way or going that way. So the x1 has to be z0 cross z1. So it is orthogonal to O2A1, right? So roughly direction, either x1 is like this or it is in this direction. So you measure theta 1 either like this or you measure theta 1 like this, depending on how you have run your z1 axis. So one needs to be careful with this to understand what theta 1 is in this concept. It is obviously, I mean, you can come out with many more solutions. I mean, instead of going through this process, if you just looked at this top view geometry, you could have said, okay, fine, I know this is Px, Py in the top view of the robot. So this angle is tan inverse Px, Py, and this angle, you could found this angle as cosine of inverse cos inverse of d2 upon r. And so then you can do the trigonometry, you can find this angle pretty much. So you get a trigonometric solution. The only thing is then you have to understand that you need this angle. Now all of this, finding this method, this angle that you are dealing with this angle and not this angle, everything is automatic if you use the matrix method that we are trying to follow. So your probability of error goes down and you will not release a manipulator in the market which, you know, while it is positioning a patient for a gamma, you know what is a gamma ray treatment, right? Cancer, right? You just want to make sure that instead of, you know, cutting out a 5 millimeter cube from your pancreas, it doesn't cut it out from your gallbladder, okay, because you got the wrong angle in there. It has actually happened. So now, so we know theta 1, okay. So we can do a little bit more with the same RHS matrix that we had. So okay, we know theta 1. Now let us look at now terms in the, because left hand side is now known completely. So everything on that side is known. Now are there any terms in this matrix which are functions only of a single joint variable? We see immediately these two. Okay. So we say, oh, this is very nice. So maybe I have something there. But actually it is not, because d3 is also a variable in this case, right? But d3 is there in both of them. So I know s2 d3, I know c2 d3. So if I am finding, trying to find the tangent 8n, I can find theta 2 pretty much by using 8n2 again. Okay, so one term is this is supposed to be c1 px plus c1 py. So using this, I can find the second joint angle uniquely. Okay, the only requirement is that d3 should stay strictly less than 0. See, if d3 becomes negative, then this 8 and 2 thing doesn't work, right? Because I should be either writing minus this and minus of that. So then it will flip to the, from the first quadrant, it will flip to the third quadrant in the solution. But in this case, what is d3? It is, you have this axis and finally I have this axis. It's the distance between this axis and this axis, right? Now this term really in a physical construction can never be negative, because for that this whole portion has to come in and slip out through the guide. Now the guide contains bearings, and you know that if you slip it out through the bearings, it's difficult to put it back. And first and second thing is that for this to move like this, there must be drives and everything in here. So nothing is going to let, you are not going to let a physical construction such that, you know, you can move this so that you can drive this thing out of the own bearing and sockets. I think none of us is so stupid, right? We know the implications of running it through there. So we'll never let it happen. So d3 will always be positive, and we can use this equation fairly safely. Okay. And then so obviously now if I know theta 2, I can use this equation to quickly find d3. Right? So now we look at the third equation in that series. So expand it, you get these function terms. So you get this, and this, the RHS is equal to this. Okay. Now, when I told you earlier that I can use this equation to evaluate d3, you should have told me immediately that that will give me two solutions. Isn't it? No, this will give you only one solution, sorry. D3 is equal to just P2 upon, okay, C2 is known, sorry. it is known here, and the same thing is available here. Now, this equation is somewhat interesting. Let us look at this term. So, this is very similar to the previous case, right? There is C4, S4, and both are divided by, both are multiplied by S5. So, I can find the tan of theta 5 and I can use the tan 2 function to derive that. Okay. Now, this can happen if S5 is strictly positive. Again, the same, I'll end up with the same issue. Okay. Now, is that always doable? Like in the earlier case, I had a stipulation that D3 needed to be strictly positive, and I said there is a physical reason why that length has to be strictly positive, but that is not true for theta 5. In fact, theta 5 can definitely be 0, okay, if the axes are aligned, so on and so forth. So, how do we handle this? So, first let us look at the case when theta 5 is equal to 0. So, which means both these terms I am looking at will become 0. So, if both of these terms are simultaneously 0, it means that theta 5 has to be equal to 0, because it is not possible that C4 and S4 are simultaneously 0, right? They cannot be simultaneously 0. Now, so fine, let us say this is the case. So, this is 0, this is 0. So, cosine of 5 is equal to 1. Okay. So, this whole matrix simplifies and becomes this, which is very interesting. Why is it interesting? What is this term equal to? C4 6, this term, S 6 4, you look at it carefully, there is not a single term, the whole matrix just becomes theta 4 plus theta 6, theta 4 plus theta 6. There is no additional information. Okay, it is almost like, well, we know theta 5, but there is nothing here will tell me what is theta 4 and what is theta 6. Every term contains theta 4 plus theta 6. Okay. And so you cannot determine theta 4 and theta 6 separately. You can only determine theta 4 plus theta 6. Now, why does this happen? And this is a situation which is called a singular configuration. Now, let us have a look at this closer. So, what happens? So, we are now just looking at the end effector area. So, theta 5 is a rotation about this axis, theta 4 is a rotation about this axis, and theta 6 is a rotation about this axis. Now, when theta 5 is equal to 0, this theta 6 axis and the theta 4 axis, they line up together, right. So, now if you tell me that, okay, you move the end effector by 30 degrees, obviously, I cannot decide just based on this information whether I should move this 20 and this 10 or move 15, 15. Both of them will move it by 30 degrees about this direction. Okay. So, that is why we have this particular problem. Now, what are the other problems that you can have? So, definitely if I spin theta 4, I can get angular velocity about this axis, right. If I spin theta 5, I can get angular velocity about the vertical axis. Currently, there is nothing that I can do to get angular velocity about the axis which is normal to both the theta 5 axis and the theta 4 axis. That is the axis which is going in like that. That is what I am saying, that you cannot take the jaw and bend it like this right now. You do not have the option. If you give me any other combination of angular velocity, as long as it does not contain a component which is in this direction, I can achieve it, but I cannot make this have an angular velocity in this direction. This motion is simply not possible in this configuration. So the manipulator has lost a degree of freedom which it normally has, and so it is called a singularity. It's an exception. And why does it happen? Because theta 5 is equal to 0. Okay. So this is the catch, and so this case is trapped very neatly by following the matrix thing, because immediately you look at the matrix and say, okay, fine, this is fine. I can find a solution except when S5 is equal to 0. Then it's okay. Now this is a funny case. So I look into that in more detail, and then these kind of things come out to you physically that there is a problem. So how do you handle this? So you get solutions for theta 4 plus theta 6 and sine theta 4 plus theta 6. So you just solve for it. And so now I'm looking at this case when theta 5 is equal to 0. Okay. So you bring it down to a point, you solve for theta 4 plus theta 6, then you say, now how do I determine what is theta 4 and what is theta 6? So an easy algorithm to use is that you say, I'll keep theta 4 whatever it is, and I'll just move theta 6 to reorient it. Why do you want to do that? Because usually that will be the smaller motor. Okay, so less power. I mean, there's a lot, I mean, you could have, you know, mathematically you could have used moved either of them, but idea is that you move that. And it's also carrying the smaller rotary inertia at the end of it. So every way speaking, is the more efficient thing to do. So you simply keep theta 4 where it is, and you move theta 6, right? And theta 5 is equal to 0. So you have a solution at the end of it. Okay. So we'll stop here today. The next class we'll just take this forward a little bit more.